Good morning. And thank you to the choir for that beautiful prelude. I invite you now to stand if you are able and join in our call to worship. God is loving and merciful. God is so good. God is good.
All the time.
All the time, God is good. Let us remain standing and join in Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. That's number 384 in our hymnal. Be seated. Let us join together now in our opening prayer. Let us pray together. O God, you have called us to be ambassadors for the love of Christ, which is gracious and transformative. As we worship you today, may we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are loved and that we never walk alone. Fill us with your Spirit so that all that we do might bring you glory and extend your tender mercies. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, again, welcome to the service of worship today, and a special welcome to Anthony Vicari of Yorktown United Methodist Church. And of course, Ariana, you know, is going to be speaking today, Ariana Fernandez. And also just want to thank Anthony's mom, Wendy, for joining us today. How nice. It's great. So today is one great hour of sharing, as well as our focus on Bolivia mission. So it's an exciting day. One Great Hour of Sharing is all about missions, and the money raised from One Great Hour of Sharing goes to UMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief, for disaster relief and other missions work. So it's really a mission Sunday. So if you'd like to make a special offering for One Great Hour of Sharing, the envelope is right in your bulletin today. And I'm going to call on our lay leader to share about some more missional opportunities and learning opportunities. Bruce?
Good morning. I'm wearing a few hats today. Just one little added thing about One Great Hour of Sharing. This offering today, overhead for UMCOR. Any other donations that go to UMCOR, 100% of that money goes to the mission. So that's why this particular offering is quite important. And it helps to cover the administrative costs to do the mission like these young folks just came back from. So I can't stress enough the importance of it. The other thing is we are offering a lay servants course, and what that is a course about Methodism, what it's basically about, and one of the things that Methodists are famous for, and that is mission work and helping others in the community. So it's being taught right here at Mamaroneck by Pastor Karen and somebody else. It's me, yes. I guess I better start reading the book. So anyway, we do have some space left to accommodate some folks, so if you're interested, I would greatly appreciate you come and see the pastor or myself. It's two Saturdays. It's this coming Saturday, and then I believe it's April 2nd. And it's from, the notice says from 9 to 4, but it's really 9 to 3, and we might cheat on that if I can talk fast. So anyway, so much for lay servants. My next hat is that this coming Friday, St. John's Lutheran Church over on Fenimore Road is doing a midnight run. And so we support them by preparing some lunches for them along with a couple of other churches in our group. So I would love to have some volunteers to make up the lunches, and I have some bags with me. So if you would kindly raise your hand, I'll bring some bags to you. Great, thank you.
Also, a Korean version of the lay servant class will be held here on the same day. So during our coffee and fellowship at 9, we'll get to meet the Korean Methodists as well that are taking lay servants. So that's another nice feature of being part of that class. You'll get to meet Korean Methodists as well. Sisters Group has a book discussion coming up again on the 19th of March. And you, woman of the church, is welcome to join Sisters Group. They're also doing outreach each month. I wanted to say a word of thanks to Carol Smith. She's been busy setting up a beautiful mission bulletin board. So when you go into coffee hour today, not only will you have a presentation of photos from the Youth Ambassadors and Mission that will be running through the coffee hour, but you can look at the board and see photos of both Nicaragua and Bolivia. So thank you, Carol, for a beautiful bulletin board. Real quick, I know there's a lot of announcements today. Just don't forget that you can still reserve Easter flowers in honor or memory of a loved one. The form is in your bulletin. We have some children's activities coming up, a family fun night on the 20th with stained glass painting, and then March 27th on Easter, we have the annual Easter egg hunt, so our children have a lot of good things to look forward to. And also, next Sunday, Soul Shine Band will be playing in worship. And I'm just really want to say thank you again to, you know, Anthony and Ariana for their willingness to bring a message to us during our service today, which you'll hear in just a few minutes about their trip. So we really appreciate that. I also just want to thank Ron for filling in as the reader today, as Alan had a conflict come up. So thank you, Ron, for being our liturgist today. All right. I'm going to invite the children to come on up.
So this is a famous sculpture, and it's called La Cathédrale. What do you think that means in French? La Cathédrale. Do you have an idea? Oh, that's a really good guess. Why did you guess together? It's not together, but two hands together. That's a really good thought. What does it look like? What is, it looks like a heart. Oh, that's really good too. Any other thoughts about what it looks like? Have you ever seen the thing where you say, where you do your hands and you make the sign of a church and you open it up and there's all the people in the church? No? You do know that? Here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. She knows it. So cathedral means cathedral. Do you know what a cathedral is? It's a big church. This church looks a lot like a cathedral. So what's interesting though, when we see hands, we often think of praying hands. Can you all do some praying hands? Right? And so what that reminds us of is that wherever we are can be church. It doesn't have to be in a big and beautiful building or a cathedral or a sanctuary, but wherever you are, you put your hands together and you can have church and you can pray to God, right? And so what are some of the things that we pray about? What are some things? Beautiful. So when your family member travels, you pray for her safe travels. That's beautiful. It's always good to pray for people traveling. What else? For good dreams when you go to sleep. That's beautiful. A lot of times people say prayers right before they go to sleep. That's a good time. Or when they first wake up in the morning, right? There's different times that you could pray. What else do we pray for? We talk to God, right? For poor people, that's great. So people who might need what? If they didn't have a lot of money, what might they need that we could pray for? Food? What else? Money? What about what's on you to keep you warm? Clothing? What about a roof over their head, like a house or shelter or apartment? Blankets, that's good. Yeah? Jobs, there's a really good prayer. Excellent, excellent. So we pray really about all different things in life. We pray for peace in the world. We pray for people around the world. We prayed for Ariana and Anthony and all the teenagers who were on the trip, right, to Bolivia. Remember when we prayed for them and we looked at the doll from Bolivia and we prayed for their safe travels and for the work that they would do and the friends they would make in Bolivia. So prayer is really important. It's our way of talking to God, and it also is a way that we help other people, isn't it? So I'm going to invite Robin up too, because today I brought a little dish that says, "Give us this day our daily bread." Does anyone know what that's from? Yeah? Yes, it's from the prayer that people call the Our Father, or what's another name for it? You know the prayer. Sometimes we call it the Lord's Prayer, because Jesus taught that prayer to us, and it covers a lot of things, right? Did you want to say it? Hallowed be thy name. Deep breath. Very good. Thank you. Well, that's great. We'll be talking about more of that prayer. The congregation is happy that you know that, so they're clapping for you. That's really nice. That's their way of celebrating. But give us this day our daily bread relates to what you were saying about food, when people need food. So everybody needs food every day, right? Or pretty much every day. Sometimes you can go without it for a little period of time, but you always have to drink liquids. But the point is, we really need food, right? It's important. So Robin's going to show you the signs for give us this day our daily bread, some ways that you can do that with sign language. You guys are good at it, too. Like you're extending your hand to give something, right? Give. Yeah. us. She's such a good teacher of the signs. And when we pray for our daily bread, we also pray for others' daily bread, right? And one more thing I want to tell you about daily bread. Some people think about the bread that we get from God, meaning God's lessons for us, God's wisdom, like we have in the Bible, right? So we ask for our daily bread. We're also saying, teach us every day. Teach us something, oh God, every day. All right, you can put your coins in. And you've brought coins, you're welcome to add it for our coins for mission, or dollars, whatever you decide, that's fine. We won't stop you from putting a dollar in if you like. Great. Okay, guys, that is excellent. Let's have a prayer and then you can go for Sunday school, okay? Thank you for helping with all that signing and great answers today. And pray. Dear God, thank you that we can talk to you wherever we are. Everywhere becomes a cathedral, and we put our hands together and say a prayer. And we pray that all the people of the world will be blessed by you. Amen.
As we all remember, the Israelites had escaped from slavery in Egypt under the leadership of Moses, and then journeyed in the wilderness for many long years. During that time, they were fed by a miraculous substance called manna, which would appear overnight on the ground and then disappear by mid-morning or early afternoon, so they would collect only enough for them to eat that particular day. Now, Moses has passed away, and his successor, Joshua, has led the people of Israel into the promised land. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away from you the disgrace of Egypt, and so that place is called Gilgal to this day." While the Israelites were encamped in Gilgal, they kept the Passover in the evening on the 14th day of the month in the plains of Jericho. On the day after the Passover, on that very day, they ate the produce of the land, unleavened cakes and parched grain. The manna ceased on the day they ate the produce of the land, and the Israelites no longer had manna. They ate the crops of the land of Canaan that year. Our second lesson comes from the second letter of Paul to the church in Corinth, also chapter 5. "From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And then finally, our gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 15, a very familiar part of the gospel. So I would ask that you try and listen to it as if you've never heard it before. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me.' So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Powerful story, isn't it, from Jesus? 562 is our hymn. Let's turn to it, stand and sing before the message. 562.
Jesus, Lord, we hold to thee.
want to lead into the real message today, which is the Bolivia team message, by just noting some things about the parable we heard today of the prodigal son. It's a powerful parable, isn't it? The younger son thinks he wants something out in the world beyond his family, asks for his inheritance early, then squanders it, and then comes back and is envious of the pigs for the pods that they're eating. So he humbles himself and offers, he thinks he will offer to work for his father, but instead he's surprised by his father's grace and love running to meet him and is welcome back. But to me, one of the most interesting things about the parable is the older brother's reaction, and the older brother resenting him and thinking that he is superior to his brother because his brother has made some mistakes. So what I wanted to do was just draw a quick connection with a shift in mission philosophy that has gone on in the world, at least in our denomination and in some others. It is, in a sense, a shift of family dynamics. And it's a shift that Reverend Joseph Awudzi has talked to some of us about recently. And Reverend Awudzi shares from his own experience in both receiving missionaries as a child who helped him in his life, but also did some things that weren't helpful, and then coordinating missions for our conference. So the older missions philosophy was sort of like the older brother thinking he had all the answers. Let's go to places, foreign lands, and we'll bring not only the gospel of Jesus, but we'll bring our culture. And so missionary work and colonialism, unfortunately, got just a little too intertwined. And so there was a sense that I know better than you. But thankfully, there's been a shift in family dynamics in the human family and in the missions family in the world and the Christian family. So that now we have more awareness that because there were these prejudices that crept in of cultures versus other cultures, developed world versus developing world, and all of these different things, there's now a different philosophy of missions where all in the family are equal and all are learning from each other and collaborating. And so when people go to another country, they're learning as much as they're bringing something, right? And they're partnering, and it's not a looking down. So I just thought it was kind of interesting that that lection came up today of the prodigal son. The father in the parable is often thought of as God, and that's one interpretation, and God loves both sons in the parable, and God loves people of all countries and cultures. And so I think in that spirit, we can rejoice that there's been a shift in family dynamics in the world of missions, at least in the Methodist Church, and I know in other denominations as well. Many denominations have made that shift. So on that positive note, I'm going to invite Anthony to start us off in sharing about the youth ambassadors in mission from our conference.
Okay, hi, I'm Anthony Vigari. I'm from the Yorktown United Methodist Church. And I heard about this trip in like December or January, one of those 2 months. My pastor was like, hey Anthony, you're good with kids, right? And I was like, I don't know. And he was like, I thought he was gonna ask to like babysit, to be honest. And I was like, oh gosh. And he was like, well, I know you're good with like doing outside work. So my friend, Reverend E. Woodsy, is doing a mission trip to Bolivia. And I was like, oh my goodness, Bolivia. Is that in like Africa or something? I've never heard of Bolivia. He was like, no, that's in South America. I was like, oh boy. And he was like, yeah, I really wanna have you go and represent our church. And my church has like a decent amount of youth, and I was surprised he picked me out of everyone. So I was really excited for that. And then I really looked into like Bolivia in itself, and I found like all this cool stuff. Like the first thing that popped up was a huge Jesus statue. And I was like, whoa, a Jesus statue. I thought that was in Brazil, but there's another one in Bolivia. And then like, I talked more to my pastor about it. And my mom was like, oh, this is gonna be a great experience. So then we all hopped on board and we got to it. And then like a week before leaving, my friend came over and saw all my bags packed and was like, why are you packing? We have February break, aren't you staying? And I was like, no, I'm going to Bolivia. He's like, why are you going to Bolivia? That's like the oddest spot to go to. And I was like, I'm going on a mission trip. He's like, why are you going on a mission trip? And I told him, there's 8 billion people in this world, roughly. Don't quote me on that. And we are all God's children. And if one of God's children needs help, we should all go and help. So, and then my friend was all like weirded out and left the house. So, so that happened. But we are all God's children. So that was my motive on going. If a brother or sister needs help, we should go and help. I also do another mission trip called UMArmy. It stands for United Methodist Action Relief Mission by Youth. And I do that in the summer. And we go to like people who can't work on their house because of like physical or mental needs. We go and do work for them. And I was thinking like, oh, how is this trip gonna be similar to UMArmy? And I was like, okay, yard work versus construction. How bad can it be? And then once we got there and saw what we actually had to do, I was like, oh my goodness. And we pretty much had to start building a church. They just had dirt and holes, and we had to make columns for them. Overall, it was a great experience. If any of the youth are able to go next year, definitely go. Reverend E. Woodsy is like the best guy in the world. And just all the things that you learn while going there is just absolutely amazing. And what I really learned was that in Bolivia, you would give up anything to go help your church. We had like 10 workers who took off for the whole week just to work and help us. Like, they live in poverty and have zero money, and they took off work to have no money just to help us build the church. And one of the guys told us that that once the church has enough money to pay for all expenses, like for cement and metal and everything, that they send out an invitation to everyone in the church congregation. And then they tell all their families, and their families to all their friends and everyone. Then everyone comes to the church to help on that one day. And he told us that on that day, they normally finish building the church. And I was like, that would never happen in the US. You couldn't ask people to come build a church and have a church be done that day. And it was just amazing. And no one gets paid for working and building that church. And it was just amazing. And just everything down there was just gorgeous. Like, they pretty much had dirt roads, and the dirt roads were like amazing. They take care of the dirt roads, and it was just a beautiful place. I wish I could go back, to be honest. And everyone there treated you with like the most, I don't know. They just treat you with the most respect. Like, they don't know you, but they're like hugging you, like welcoming you. Like, pretty much like you're their sibling, or like they're your mother. It was really weird. Like, you would just walk into the church and they'd be like, oh my gosh, how was your day? And I was like, good, thanks for asking. And it was just the people there, the environment, everything was different than the US. It was just a great time and a great experience. Yeah, I don't know what else to say. We built four concrete columns to help with the church. We also did, what was it?
Rhubarb?
I don't know if I'm saying that right, but yeah, that stuff. for like the roof, we did three to two, full like 20 feet long like posts for the roof, and we did a VBS whole thing. With the VBS, they didn't tell us that we were actually gonna run VBS. They told us that we were gonna help out, so we thought that they had a curriculum for us, and we were told that hey, you guys are running it. And we're like, oh no. So we had to think of a whole curriculum during the week. I ended up like doing a lot of cool stuff, but it was kind of hard since almost none of us spoke Spanish. So trying to translate stuff was really hard. We had like 2 to 3 translators, one being a teen and another one or two being like adults that just came with us. But just the kids were so excited once they saw us. And on the last day, they actually ran after us and jumped onto the bus while we were driving away, which is very scary. Like, we were dragging kids going down the street. So that's how much excitement they had for us being there. And like the memories that we gave to them. So that's all I got.
My experience in Bolivia was unforgettable. When we finally arrived after the 15-hour plane ride, we were greeted by the biggest welcoming party I've ever seen in my whole life so far. At the airport, there were so many people waiting and singing and dancing and playing music that is traditional in Bolivia. They gave us necklaces tied with flowers and gave us hugs and kisses. They were really happy that we came to help. And they already had so much love for us, which at the point we were strangers, and they treated us as if we were family to them. In just the short time that I was there, I learned so much from the people in Cochabamba. Every day we worked on building the church in Lava Lava. It's a community full of people from the mountains of Bolivia. They speak mostly Quechua, which is the native language of Bolivia. So there was a huge language barrier there. At the work site, we learned how to be patient with tying rebar, making cement, and learning about the people that work there. Most of the workers, like Anthony said, were volunteers, and they took off from work just to help build their church. The days working at the construction site were never boring. The workload was repetitive. We did the same thing every day, but it was different because there was different people there working with us. There was kids to talk to. The dogs were really cute. Our team accomplished a lot in just the short stay that we were there for. We built 4 columns and we helped expand the top of the second floor. They told us that the church is gonna take at least 5 years to build. But they said that they hope that more people will come in the following years to help build the church. Every day at the work site was enjoyable. I think the weather was the major key in that. It was never cold, unlike here. When I left here, it was cold and windy, and I didn't want to come back. And I grew a nice farmer's tan while I was there. Came back in gym class, where they were looking at me. They were like, And one day I remember the workers' wives actually prepared a meal for us to share with them. It was potatoes and lima beans. They were freshly grown, and they taught us how to peel it. We peel it like bananas and we eat them like apples, and inside were nice friendly critters to meet you. Yeah, so you knew that it wasn't, you know, pesticides weren't put into the food. And you know, I bit into it and I saw some nice animals. It was nice, yeah. And you know, there was no seasonings to go with it. They only gave us salt, and I guess that's how it should be. I mean, it's a meal, it should nourish you and fill you, and that's what it did. It doesn't have to be fast. And what else? Application Bible School, or VBS. The kids were so energetic. Some of them came dressed in dresses and suits because they felt the need to dress up for church. And on the last day, it was really emotional. They were so eager to learn English, and they wanted to learn about the cameras that we were using. And So the last day we made a cross out of hands that we cut out, and we asked them to put their names, and we formed it in a cross, and we gave them shirts that said, God loves you in Spanish. And, you know, the whole message of giving us the shirts wasn't to actually come back and say, oh, we changed them. We gave them a shirt. They're now dressed appropriately according to us, because they're a shirt doesn't have to be clean and crisp and not wrinkled. It just you just have to have it. And I guess it's different there because they're actually rich in their heart and they actually love. The priority there is love and helping the community. And so I have a gift for Pastor Karen.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. So you can add this to your collection of stoles from Bolivia.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
That's so sweet. Thank you.
And I also have a gift for the church. It's in the coffee hour, and you can see it later, along with pictures from my trip.
I really like what you just said about rich in heart. Was that the phrase you used? That they were rich in heart, and they weren't worried about whether a shirt was torn or not, because they were focused on the heart. That's really nice to share about that. And I love that you had so much fun, Anthony. Yeah. It just sounds like you're a fun person. You'd be fun to be on a trip with, don't you think? You both would, but I think you have a particular humor gift. So it just seemed like you were having a ball with this. And I think both of you, what you're saying too, is you're talking about hospitality, because you're talking about a joyful welcome, turning out to help with the work, and then seeing them off, you know, with joy. And it's like a hospitality. It's like we're really, you know, and that is something that I think we can always learn about, you know, in our culture, to show hospitality to people who are from other places, you know, and show that welcome and that hospitality. So let's just affirm our volunteers in mission, our youth ambassadors in mission and for Christ. And can you stand again? We just want to thank you again for going. It's really good. And of course, they invite you to coffee hour to see some pictures that'll be projected, as well as the ones that Carol has posted on the wall, and to ask questions. I'm sure there are questions that you have for them about their experience as well. But I like that you said also that, you know, that we're one family, and that came through in your trip.
Yeah.
And then, you know, that was, again, the parables message, too. We're one family. That's really neat. So thank you again for sharing and for getting up and sharing with the congregation, because I know if you're not used to that. But you guys seem very comfortable speaking. Thank you. That's great.
Okay, you can
relax. And so at this time, then, we are going to take up our morning offering for the work of Christ as our choir prepares us for communion with their offertory anthem.
Thank you.
Let us rise and dedicate our offerings together to our Lord. Have given us many opportunities to build bridges between people and to make friends around the world and around our community. We thank you, we praise you for these opportunities, and we praise you for the work and the sharing that is done. I ask you now to bless all who have given to this offering, that as they give, they might feel the Holy Spirit filling their hearts, because they're following your way, and that all those blessed through the gifts would also be anointed by your Spirit and blessed. Amen. And please be seated. I invite you now to join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us prepare to celebrate communion together.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Amen.
Son Jesus Christ, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, O God, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Spirit on us gathered here, O God, and on these gifts, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Just a moment, then. We'll invite you to come up and simply break a piece of the bread off and dip it in the cup we received by intinction. Or we have gluten-free wafers that I'll have available. So I'd invite our communion stewards now to come up to help serve. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. And our final hymn, in the spirit of the prodigal son, Grace Greater Than Our Sin, 365.
Be loved by our Heavenly Father, embraced, and welcomed home each day. Amen. Once again, I want to invite you to a special coffee hour with some Bolivian food. Thank you to Cassandra, Ariana, Cecilia, and also Anthony and his family for this special hospitality they're showing us today. So come on in and enjoy. Amen.